Joe was in Dublin, I was in Sheffield, the other guys were in America. We thought we're going to make a record at some point. The idea was to just get together in Joe's studio just for a month, and maybe if we get two or three songs out of that little session, it'll be something that we can build on when we're not on tour, and hopefully, you know, in two or three years' time, have a finished record. On the day that we were due to meet, lockdown was basically enforced and put a completely different spin on the whole thing. We decided, like, well, okay, we could still make a record, but this time it just means that we're not in the same room and there's no real time frame on finishing the thing. Let's just have a little bit of fun with it, write what we think and record it, you know?
Yeah, I can see that, because what you've got is, instead of five alpha males becoming one in a room where you're trying to hammer out a direction, what you got is five individuals let off the leash to go wherever they wanted to, and four other people allowing that one person, whichever one of us it was, to go off in that direction. So if Sav came out with a song that was like very different to anything he's ever written before, but we liked it, it's in. If I came in with a song that was written on a piano, it wasn't transposed back into guitars, it was left as a piano song. And if Phil came in with a song that started on a ukulele, fine. And this is what he did. It gave us the freedom to try other things without peer pressure of people in the same room. Fire it up. We're still dealing with it.
Yeah.
It's not a musical thing, it's a time thing. And I've always said that. It's like, just because we happen to rear our ugly head at the same time as Saxon and Iron Maiden, we get put into the same bracket as those bands. As good as they are, we don't sound anything like each other. And to do it from a timing point of view, they might as well have thrown us in the same bracket as Duran Duran and Spandau Ballet. In fact, to be quite honest, I think we're probably more musically attuned to those two. But yeah, we were born out of a totally different musical background. I think that out of those three bands I just mentioned, we would be the most likely to put our hands in the air and say yes to Slade, yes to Sweet, Bowie, T-Rex, Queen, Mott the Hoople, even Roxy Music. Anything that was just a bit more unusual, Sparks, something that would just like illuminate our week when we were 12 or 13 years old, because when you heard Sparks doing This Town Ain't Big Enough for the Both of Us, or you heard Roxy Music doing Do the Strand, or Queen doing Killer Queen, they stood out as being different. They were almost alien to what else was in the charts. We've got a massive amount of admiration for the Uriah Heeps of this world, and Sabbath, and Zeppelin, and etc. But I think the bigger picture is the Beatles and the Stones that were the daddies of everything. I don't know which one was the mom and which one was the dad, but you know, it was all about songs. You know, with the glam rock thing, it was about the image, but there were some great songs where they were written by Mark Bolan or David Bowie or Chin and Chapman, whoever it was. We were born out of that singles, or into that singles market, where you could listen to a Slade song and think it's the greatest thing in the world, but you wouldn't necessarily buy a Slade album. Whereas if it was Zeppelin, you don't buy the singles because they didn't release them. You just bought the albums. It was a different world, but that was the world we were born into, and it was colour TV for the first time, and it was Top of the Pops. It was little 3-minute hits, and that's what they were. We would cherry pick great songs that would become who we would become. So when we get lumped into this new wave of whatever, or in America it was the hair metal thing, it never made any sense to us that there were people putting us into the same bracket as all these bands on Sunset Boulevard, while we were locked away in Holland next to a windmill, recording Hysteria in Europe. You know, it didn't make any sense. But, you know, there's leanings towards metal in some of our riffs and stuff like that, no doubt. But we're more than that. And I think that's the big thing that we always get frustrated about, is that there doesn't seem to be as many people as we'd like taking notice of that fact.
Absolutely, yeah.
Totally.
Yeah. I mean, it's only sometimes after the event, because you you're so conscious when you're writing songs and just trying to be as natural as possible, and also when you're recording them. It's only as the songs begin to take shape and you can then occasionally view them in a slightly different angle, you suddenly go, you know what, some of this sounds like, it's got elements of the Eagles, it's got elements of Fleetwood Mac, it's got elements of Pink Floyd. All these artists that were predominant in the 70s. It's something that you suddenly, like, you just see and recognise kind of after the event.
Yeah.
Yes, it's like, yes, it's absolutely as glam tendencies as well. But the whole soul of it has got a 71 to 74 sort of era about it, you know. Not entirely planned or anything like that. It's just that's how it turned out. Back then, it was very pigeonholed. There was rock magazines or papers. There was metal magazines, even radio. It's like everything was like just so categorized. Whereas now, because of the internet, etc., etc., anything is available to the individual. So obviously, in time, it will open people's eyes.
And I think personally, the biggest everything there is YouTube. I think it's just perfect. You can go down so many burrows, you know. It's like going into it's like a Lewis Carroll novel. You know, somebody will say, go watch this link, and it might be a live, the new Pink Floyd single with the Ukrainian singer. And down the side of it, there's Billy Connolly telling a joke. And then you click on that, and from that, you go to an old episode of Zed Cars. It just takes you everywhere. And if you've got the time, and you're not just stuck in one rut, you know, you're going off on tangents. And I think that's just more, it's better for open-minded people, it's better to be open-minded, you know, I mean, like everything, good or bad, you know, you shouldn't restrict yourself to one type of music. We're huge fans of anything that just appeals to us. Kate Bush, Motorhead, Clannad, UFO, it doesn't matter. If you like it, you like it. It is very flattering. It was nice to hear the guy from Ghost saying, yeah, I wanted to write a song like those guys used to do, where you hear the bridge, and then you hear the next bridge, thinking it's the chorus, but then it goes back to the verse, and then you hear the first bridge, and then the second, then you hear the chorus. They say, I was thinking God's of War, you know. And, you know, the fact that he wasn't afraid or embarrassed to name check us, a lot of bands would be, that you'd be amazed how many people like us, but they won't admit it, musician-wise, you know. We've got loads of fans. I don't know, because it's commercially successful, and it doesn't have the same credibility as saying that you like Elvis Costello or REM or U2 or something like that. We're seen or deemed in the past have been deemed to be like fluff, I suppose. But it's fun and all that lot, but it doesn't have any substance. It's complete nonsense, of course.
And I actually think it's changing.
Yeah.
I think what Joe's saying definitely applied a good few years ago. I think it's like a lot of things. We've proved ourselves so, you know, so many times in the past. And with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction, people are starting to take us seriously and actually listen to us a little bit more and actually go, you know what, there is some real substance to the group. And I think people are now, it's been easy to dismiss us as just been like this sort of flowery rock stroke metal band that appealed to the masses one time. There's actually more to us than that, and I think people are actually getting it.